Yes. Woo! That was an intro. Good morning.
Good morning.
How's everyone doing? We all have our coffees, juice. We're ready. Ready to get your conservative inner geek on for the next hour? Good. Good. Well, my presentation, what is conservatism? What does it mean to be a conservative? A lot of you are here. Part of the training is to understand and get a better idea of what does that mean, that word conservative, these days. And just before I begin, I just want to quickly thank Young America's Foundation, Ron Robinson, Pat, Jolie, and the team for inviting me to speak. This is my sixth time speaking here, and I come here because of you guys. And I don't just say that offhand. I mean, I'm serious. You guys inspire me. You all love your country. You believe in something greater than yourself. And you're not little snowflakes. But instead, you're revolutionaries, real revolutionaries. Why? Because you're in the belly of the beast and at ground zero for the battle of the hearts, minds, and souls that is taking place in every college campus around the country. But fear not, I think it's safe to say that Young America's Foundation is safe space for conservatives. Do you agree? Okay. As Jolie said, my name is Chris Malagisi, and I'm the editor-in-chief of the Conservative Book Club. It's kind of like the Oprah Winfrey Book Club, but for the right. I'm a recovering CPAC director and was the education director for Conservatism 101 for a while. But for 7 years, I taught as an adjunct professor at American University, teaching a course called History of the Conservative Movement, which was an undergraduate and graduate-level course that explored the philosophical and political foundations of the most influential movement in modern American political history. So I'm taking my 14-week course and I've jam-packed it into 1 hour. So it should be fun. But for many of you that are probably familiar with the basic tenets of conservatism, you're here today at Young America's Foundation because you're interested in digging deeper to learn more about your own political philosophy. I'm going to give you a disclaimer that my speech is not going to be as flashy as a Milo Yiannopoulos or even a Ben Shapiro. But my goal, is in these great beginnings, as this gathering is called, is to challenge you to dig deep. As I want you all to walk away from this presentation truly having a better understanding of conservatism and have your spirits renewed fighting your battles on campus as emerging leaders in the conservative movement. So, the best definition I've ever read of conservatism is based on five simple ideas. And this is straight from the Heritage Foundation. It's one of the leading conservative, the leading conservative think tank in the country. Free people, free markets, limited government, a strong national defense, and preserving our traditional values or the civil society. But like any cogent philosophy, one must ask, where did these ideas come from? In the second part, with some prepared statements here, we're going to explore the foundation and the roots of American conservatism. But in order to begin, let's ask ourselves one question. What are conservatives inherently trying to conserve? You know, this is the first question I ask on the very first day of class and with all my students. And most of the time, the students are kind of puzzled in giving an answer. It's a question not asked as often as it probably should, and is sometimes hard to put in easy to understand digestible terms. So typical responses tend to be, you know, conservatives want to lower taxes, they tend to be pro-life, and they want to win wars. Okay, but inherently, what are conservatives inherently trying to conserve? The answer is America's first principles, or what others might call American exceptionalism. What is American exceptionalism? Well, American exceptionalism is the idea that America is a unique chapter in the annals of human history. America is unique not because we were against a tea tax and fought off a colonial power to gain our independence. While important, that's not what makes America unique, as many countries have fought wars of independence before too. No, America is unique because it claimed a new basis of political legitimacy, that all men are created equal, that political legitimacy is derived from the consent of the governed, and that our rights do not come from government, but come from the laws of nature and nature's God. Well, what does this mean? Let's take each one of these three and break them down. In the Declaration of Independence, it states that all men are created equal with certain inalienable rights, which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. This implies that while individuals might be born into different socioeconomic classes and might have different abilities, we are each, though, born equally as a human being, and that no one person may rule over another. We take this concept for granted today, but at the time of the American Revolution, this idea was really revolutionary. So if one individual cannot rule over another, would it then apply that no monarchy, aristocracy, oligarchy, dictator, or otherwise could rightly claim their rule over another? Which leads us to their second principle, that political legitimacy is derived from the consent of the governed, the people. As I just stated, if one man cannot rule over another, then doesn't it stand that only true political legitimacy comes from the consent of the people collectively? People elect representatives to represent their views in the legislature, elected by the majority of people, but where the minority's voice is also still respected. This was a historical, fundamental change in political governance, as no society of this magnitude has ever before bestowed political authority to the people themselves. And this will lead to our third principle. If all men are created equally, and true political legitimacy comes from the consent of the governed, then the question must be asked, where do these rights come from? Have you ever thought of that? Before the American founding, our rights were bestowed upon us by the British common law that passed down from one generation to the next, based on whatever decree the king or parliament allowed. All of this was based on the idea that the crown or government could decree our rights. During the Enlightenment, philosophers, including John Locke in particular, really important guy, John Locke, concluded that through reason and revelation, we could ascertain certain laws or universal truths. This would be called natural law. How many of you have heard of natural law before? Okay, great. From natural law, we could determine certain natural rights that could not be given or taken away by a government, but were inherently affixed to human nature itself. That these natural rights consisted of life, liberty, property, and the pursuit of happiness or virtue in one's life. I cannot overstate enough that this concept was a profound shift in human history. The idea of natural rights essentially meant there were certain fundamental rights that a government could not create and could not therefore take away from the individual. That instead our natural rights come from the laws of nature and nature's God. These three principles established the new political legitimacy that was to exist in America. It was this experimental fusion of ideas, if you will, that formed the basis of our American political experiment. And this is why America is still called today. Have you ever heard of referred to as the American experiment? That's why it is. It is an experiment because it is a test to see whether or not man can govern themselves, or what Alexander Hamilton would describe in Federalist Paper Number 1, quote, whether societies of men are really capable or not of establishing good government from reflection and choice, or whether they are forever destined to depend for their political constitutions on accident and force. After the Constitutional Convention of 1787, a woman came up to Ben Franklin, you may have heard the story, and she asked, what did you come up with? And Ben Franklin famously responded, anybody know? Yes? A republic, if you can keep it. Exactly. What Franklin meant was that America was to be a republic, a vestige of elected self-government where the people would determine their individual and collective destiny. Now, I know some of you at this point might be thinking, well, why aren't we discussing the conservative positions on issue A or issue B? It's a conservative presentation, right? Instead of talking about the founding, it is fundamentally important to remember that conservatives base their heritage and view of government's proper role by understanding our founding principles, based on our founding documents, the Declaration of Independence, the U.S. Constitution, and even the Federalist Papers. Quoting Mark Levin from his book, Liberty and Tyranny, he says, conservatism is the antidote to tyranny precisely because its principles are the founding principles. In this frame of mind, it must also be understood that our founders believed that liberty alone would not be enough to maintain a republic. Free men not only must have liberty, but must also be guided by experience and prudence to govern justly. You know, in the English language, there's two words for freedom: freedom and liberty. The founders did not intend for unlimited freedom, as they knew this might encroach on someone else's individual freedom. So therefore, the term liberty always implied that it's not just rights, but also responsibilities. These responsibilities would be necessary for one's freedom to be secure. Therefore, for liberty to flourish, virtue and tradition must also be cultivated through the civil society. Rights and responsibilities, or sometimes it's referred to as something called ordered liberty. Have you ever heard of John Stuart Mill and the harm principle? The theorem essentially states that individuals should be allowed to be free and do as they please so long as they do not harm others. I think most people would agree with this principle in theory, but a conservative would ask them to define what harm means, what harm is. Each person might have a different definition for this. Therefore, a conservative believes in the freedom of the individual, but also believes with great power and freedom comes great responsibility. And there should be a civic virtue and tradition to help guide our freedom. John Adams once said that, quote, statesmen may plan and speculate for liberty, but it is religion and morality alone which can establish the principles upon which freedom can securely stand. Our Constitution was made only for a moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the government of any other. What he was saying was that forming good character, building community, and promoting civic virtue were all necessary ingredients to promote the Aristotelian idea of the good society. So how would we go about promoting civic virtue but not trample upon the rights of others? The answer is through something called the civil society, entities not associated with the government. So what is civil society? Civil society consists of five institutions: our families, churches, schools, local communities, and private associations. Civil society would be the bedrock for securing our liberty through its nurturing of civic virtue, character building, and responsible citizenship. Additionally, to preserve this newfound liberty, government was to be limited based on the rule of law and something called negative rights, limiting the government's ability to limit our rights. For example, the First Amendment begins by stating that Congress shall make no law. You notice all the amendments start like that too, or very similar. It's putting a cap on the government's power. The founders understood the symbiotic relationship between liberty and governmental power. The more power a government had, the less liberty the individual had. Therefore, a set of rules was necessary to specifically list the proper functions and duties of government, enshrined within the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. The founders also created a government of checks and balances and separations of powers between the three branches, the legislative, the executive, and the judicial, to make sure that one branch would serve as a check on the other and would have its own specific powers. This way, a tyranny of the majority or a perceived tyrannical president or passionate faction could not quickly overtake or abuse governmental power. The founders knew that they could not anticipate every constitutional issue that might arise, and from time to time, the Constitution might need to be amended. Therefore, they ingeniously created Article 5 of the Constitution, which allowed it to be amended when necessary. But this was only supposed to be used in a very limited fashion, and it only has been amended 27 times in 250 plus years, not bad. Otherwise, the Constitution was to serve as a type of rulebook in administering government. This is why conservatives today promote the concept of judicial restraint or originalism. Have you heard of that before? A few of you, yes or no? Okay. Originalism is the idea that the original meaning or intent of a law provides consistency from one generation to the next. So like a contract, the law sets expectations so everyone understands the same rules. This is Antonin Scalia and Clarence Thomas and Alito. This is the type of court, the conservative type of court that you hear about all the time. Lastly, in order to promote a pursuit of happiness, our government also needed to secure our safety. This was to be done through a sovereign independence and a strong national defense. In the early days of our republic, George Washington warned us in his farewell address to be wary of foreign entanglements, as the country had nearly been torn apart by the French Revolutionary War between Americans supporting the British and supporting the French. At the time, the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution clearly states that the federal government's primary responsibility was to provide for the common defense. Does anyone remember America's first governing document? What was it called? Articles of Confederation, that's right. But that was our first constitution, and it was figuratively thrown out, in part due to the lack of the ability of the federal government to create an armed force when necessary to defend itself and its interests. It would be important for America to always be ready in cases of emergencies and to respond to acts of aggression if necessary, and only as a last resort. It is in this spirit that conservatives today believe in a strong peace through strength national defense to defend and protect itself and its interests, though many conservatives could have differing opinions to the extent of that power. In summary, conservatives trace their heritage to the American founding and deeply believe in the concept of American exceptionalism. America's first principles established a new political legitimacy based on the precepts that all men are created equal and that are self-governance and that our natural rights do not come from government but come from the laws of nature and of nature's God. These inalienable rights consist of life, liberty, property, and the pursuit of happiness. But with liberty and rights comes responsibilities, best promoted through a thriving civil society, maintaining a rule of law, judicial restraint, and a sovereign independence and a strong national defense would be tantamount to preserving the American experiment. In order to understand modern conservatism, one must be able to understand the founding and its principles, first principles. Like Levin says, conservatism is the antidote to tyranny precisely because the principles are the founding principles. That's why I call you revolutionaries, because like our founding mothers and fathers, you are fighting this tyranny on college campuses today. You're on the front lines of the greatest threats facing America, the politically correct culture, the liberal feminism, socialism, multiculturalism, a very misguided term that hides its true intentions, militant environmentalism, and my favorite, the so-called social justice movement. The founders would be aghast to learn that America has been flirting with these ideas and acting them out, as they always saw the university as an exercise in character building, learning about the classics, history, literature, and continue to educate on the ideas of Western civilization, of ancient Jerusalem, Greece, Rome, London, and its modern torchbearer, Philadelphia, the American experiment. All right, so at the beginning of this presentation, I asked what are conservatives inherently trying to conserve? The answer was our first principles and the concept of American exceptionalism. For the first 125 years of American American history, the federal government operated primarily within this limited government constitutional framework designed by our founders. Government knew its place in society and was just essentially responsible for protecting our natural rights, providing a national currency, an army when necessary, and was responsible for foreign policy. That was pretty much it. Its primary syllogism was this: the larger the government, the less freedom the individual had. With the dawn of the 20th century, though, a growing and vociferous and even nefarious movement was growing within the U.S. that would attempt to redefine the founders' vision for America. To understand modern conservatism or post-World War II conservatism, it is important to trace the roots at which point in time. Anybody ever see Back to the Future 2? I feel like I wish I had a chalkboard like Doc Brown, where I can like see the trajectory of when things change, what happened. It's important to trace the roots at which point in time the limited government trajectory of America meandered away from its founding roots. The reason a modern conservative movement even exists today is because a new philosophy of government expansion would attempt to recalibrate the Constitution. We know and we love the role in government itself and in society would change. This new threat would be called progressivism, and its followers would be called the progressives. The early progressive era was initially around 1890 to 1920 and was personified by Woodrow Wilson and then later FDR, but its effects are still felt today, even though it was in the early part of the 20th century. We're still dealing with these issues. This schism in America's trajectory is important to understand because it is the foundation for the two basic worldviews that exist today between political left and political right, progressives and conservatives. You need to understand the progressivism's goals in order to understand why a modern conservative movement exists today. So like I said, for about 125 years or so of the Republic, it was understood that the federal government was to play a very limited role in the lives of its citizens and just perform the basic duties and functions transcribed in the Constitution. By the late 1800s, early 1900s, though, society was undergoing rapid changes. You guys have probably learned about this in your school, U.S. history, AP U.S., or college history classes. These changes were due to the Industrial Revolution taking place, rampant urbanization, transportation and communication improvements, and the development of the U.S. as a world power. From what primarily started as an academic and journalistic enterprise, some began to believe that the tried and true conservative first principles that had built and nurtured to America to the point of economic prosperity and social mobility, at least comparatively to the rest of the world, were now no longer useful. In the eyes of these people, society was evolving, and therefore the Constitution needed to evolve as well, redefining the role of government and its relationship with the people. A more zealous government was needed. No longer was a limited government enough. Progressivism is the idea that government needed to force societal, political, and economic change to meet the times at hand. This change could only come through an expansion of government power. While many were well-intentioned, as the times did call for certain reforms in that time of history, their experimentation led to the modern acceptance of government largesse, and intentionally or not, resulted in trying to usurp the basic tenets of American constitutionalism, essentially the entire American experiment, that all men are created equal, and that we have certain inalienable rights that were given to us not by government, but from the laws of nature and of nature's God. According to the Heritage Foundation scholar Matthew Spaulding in his book, We Still Hold These Truths, this is one of the books that I use in my class, their ideas were based on three isms: relativism, positivism, and historicism. At the core of the progressive worldview is relativism. This is not to be confused with Einstein's theory of relativity, but the idea that there's no such thing as fixed or natural truths. Basically, according to a progressive, everything was relative or subjective to one's own individual interpretation or worldview. This theory dramatically departed from the wisdom and knowledge that had been accumulated over 2,500 years of human history and Western civilization, derived from both John Locke's Reason and Revelation. Basically, this is what this means. If there were no fixed truths, then that would imply that there are no natural truths. You have no natural rights. Only government can bestow rights on you. And the corollary to that is that a government powerful enough to create your rights is also powerful enough to take away your rights. Tyranny, the exact opposite of the intention of our American experiment. And the entire premise of our government, the founding ideas of natural law, natural rights, all men are created equal, and that our rights come from the laws of nature and of nature's God, could no longer be accepted. So it doesn't take a genius to realize that this inherent danger here and how it could lead to the abuse of as the center of power of government would shift from the individual to the government itself. The second ism is something called positivism. Positivism is based on the theory by Auguste Comte that theological and mythical metaphysical questions are essentially useless. Basically, capital T truth does not exist. Only through science alone can we learn truth. Carl Becker, who was an American historian who ascribed to positivism, once said that, quote, "To ask whether there is a natural rights philosophy in the Declaration of Independence is essentially a meaningless question. Notions of a natural moral order that can and should guide man and politics is akin to mythology." Now, the problem with this is not that science can't help us understand some of the mysteries of the universe or even help us make better public policies, but the premise that only through scientific methodology will we then be able to answer every policy question under the sun with the goal of perfecting society is flawed. This inevitably leads to policy devoid of value and rampant experimentation, which results in larger government at the sacrifice of your liberty and your pocketbooks. Anyone know the best solution to fix a government program not working? Create another government program. Ronald Reagan once said, and this is one of my favorite quotes of all time, that no government ever voluntarily reduces itself in size. Government programs, once launched, never disappear. Actually, a government bureau is the nearest thing to eternal life we'll ever see on Earth. So in other words, experimentalism is needed. Government needs to experiment with new government programs and ideas while at the same time they are nicking away at your liberty. Some of the genius programs that came out of the progressive era was the income tax, fantastic, working out great, the Federal Reserve, and essentially the death of federalism enshrined with the direct election of U.S. senators as it shifted our republic from individual but united states to a full-throated national government that could wield its power from a distant capital on all matters of life, from taxing your hard-earned earnings to ascribing who can use which bathrooms, just like Jefferson and Madison had intended, of course. Progressive educational reformer John Dewey once said, experimentalism is experimenting with and learning new ideas inevitably that will lead to change, moving toward an ever-increasing improvement and perfectibility of man and society. The movement is captured by the indefinite concept of progress. But progress to what, exactly? Again, this is not to say we shouldn't use science or analytics in creating prudent public policy, but rather for the founders, progress, real progress, was understood to be change in light of unchanging standards. Those standards, of course, were recognizing our natural rights, not just from reason, but through accumulated wisdom and revelation. The finalism is historicism. Historicism is the concept that all ideas and meaning are relevant in their moment in time. Decisions must constantly be constructed and adaptive to the times. Ideas of the past, well, are just that, only relevant to the past. In other words, what was good at the time of 1787 is no longer relevant to the modern day. Therefore, we must always reconstruct the Constitution to fit the needs of today. A great example of this is anytime Congress debates the Second Amendment and guns, picking and choosing which are rights and what's voluntary and not. Second Amendment's not a suggestion, it's a real right. The progressives believe in the idea of a living constitution, a constitution that is based on empathy instead of law, personal subjective interpretations, and a judicial activism that usurps the other branches of government from their constitutional balance of power. Activist judges would legislate from the bench and take power away from the people's elected representatives or the people themselves. As you can imagine, and as we're seeing playing out today in some of the recent Supreme Court cases, you can see where this can lead to some problems. As mentioned earlier, the genius of Article 5 of the Constitution was the Amendment Clause, which allowed for prudential change to take place as necessary. The Constitution was to serve as a consistent rule book for administering government. This is why conservatives today promote the concept of judicial restraint and originalism, the idea that the original meaning or intent of a law provides consistency from one generation to the next. If it needed to be changed, it should be done through the legislative or amendment process, not by the whim of the courts. Courts are there to interpret the law, not make the law. Like a contract, the law sets expectations so that everyone understands the same rules. If a constitution is changed from one generation to the next, what consistency can we possibly expect? Again, this is in no way means that the Constitution should remain a static document. It's not. We've amended it 27 times. In conclusion of the second part, it is important to understand that the Progressive Era was the first major recalibration of the American government and its relationship with the people. The three isms, relativism, positivism, and historicism, were antithetical to the founders' vision of America and rejected 2,500 years of human history and wisdom transcended from the great Western civilizations of ancient Jerusalem, Athens, Rome, London, and which would eventually lead to the Enlightenment, where the American experiment of republicanism, consent of the governed, and rights based on natural law was affixed. After Presidents Woodrow Wilson, FDR, and even LBJ, government's role in society had changed the foundation for the modern welfare state to have been laid. But for nearly three generations, a silent majority of Americans had slowly borne witness to this remanifestation of government, but now sought a conservative revival, back to the founders' vision of America and government's proper constitutional and limited role. That was financially, fiscally prudent, traditionalist in nature, and recognized the rising threat at the time of communism in the world as America's greatest foreign threat. After FDR and World War II, an American conservative revival was about to begin, which leads us to the foundations of now the modern American conservative movement, the last part of this presentation. All right, the founding, progressives, leads us to the making of what we know today as the modern conservative movement. And the beginning of this was after the Progressive Era, the Great Depression, and World War II. Post-1945, there began to emerge three disparate strains of thought, all trying to assess society's ills. For nearly three generations, a capricious and almost nefarious devolution of our founding principles had been ebbed away through a progressive recalibration of the government. Through Wilsonian internationalism and FDR New Dealism, the country had evolved. For the first time in three generations, the American people took a deep breath and sought solutions to a government largesse, a dispirited culture, and dealing with the rising international communist threat. It could be summed up in the immortal quote of a young rising legend of the conservative movement, William F. Buckley, Jr., who founded National Review magazine in 1955, stating in its first issue that a conservative was standing athwart history yelling, "Stop!" Three philosophical strands were taking root to answer these questions. The conservative movement itself is actually a coalition made up of three disparate yet amenable groups, the first being the classical liberals and libertarians, traditionalists and anti-communists, or modernly referred to sometimes as fiscal, social, and defense conservatives. While each entity emphasizes different issues, they all work together in a political compact of sorts with a shared sense of reason operating within tradition. They also understand that together, as a fusionist coalition, they have the best chance of winning elections and actually legislating their conservative principles. So with that, prepared a little PowerPoint to hopefully okay. Julia? There we go. Okay. All right. Sorry, I kind of skipped over this a little bit, but yeah, for 125 years or so, these guys, bad guys, progressives. It'd also be the Mount Rushmore of progressives, if they had one, by the way. Then this guy came. And okay, here we go. So the three-legged stool of conservatism. So, as I mentioned, the libertarians or classical liberals, the traditionalists, and the anti-communists were the first three major groups of conservatism and provided the intellectual foundations of our movement that we know today. The first, the libertarians and classical liberals. Who are these guys? Well, the big leaders, intellectual leaders, are people you might have heard of: F.A. Hayek, Friedrich von Hayek, and Milton Friedman, Henry Hazlitt, Arthur Laffer, those type of folks. They believed, essentially, that the emphasis of governing should be on promoting individual liberty, limited government, free markets, entrepreneurship, and less taxation. So think of like a libertarian. That's kind of essentially what their belief system is. The second group was our traditionalists. Traditionalists, some of the big leaders were Bill Buckley, Russell Kirk, very important figure who wrote a book called The Conservative Mind that made conservatism essentially intellectually defensible. Robert Nisbet and Richard Weaver were also big leaders of this movement. And what was their goal? What were they trying to do? They were basically trying to preserve the civil society, make civil society, our families, schools, churches, local communities, and private associations, the center of society, not the government. And they believed that there is a transcendent moral order. Throughout Western civilization, we've learned some things from the past that, hey, you know, the Greeks had some things right. Democracy, pretty good idea. Let's try that out. Romans had law. That's a good idea. We should probably have a rule of law. And London was kind of like the next big one that put together the first document that listed people's individual rights. And we kind of learned from those generations. The third group are the anti-communists. So these were the people who, many of them were ex-communists themselves or former liberals. They believed in a strong national defense. They saw that our country was being infiltrated by many communist spies, and that there was a certain sympathy in leftist circles for the international communism movement that was going on post-World War II. So their primary concern was protecting our homeland and our interests abroad. We wanted to win the Cold War and believed that communism was actually essentially an evil in itself, not only for the ideas of taking away liberty, but in believing in a godless society where man is God and God is not respected. So you might have heard this term, or you will hear this term at some point. Bill Buckley and Frank Meyer, these two guys here, are given credit for kind of fusing these ideas together. They understood that these three groups don't necessarily always get along because their emphases are different, but they do have some commonalities. In order to have liberty, you have to have virtue. In order to have virtue, you had to have liberty. Remember the John Stuart Mill harm principle? Be free, do whatever you please, as long as you don't harm somebody else. So that's kind of the fusion between the libertarians and the traditionalists, that through that government's end should be the liberty of the individual so that the individual can then pursue their own virtue, whatever that may be, your pursuit of happiness in your life. Everybody with me on that? Okay. The glue that kind of held them together for a very long time was anti-communism, because both libertarians abhorred communism and traditionalists abhorred it too. Libertarians didn't like it because it took away the rights of the individual. Traditionalists hated it because it was a godless society. So this worked, and it was a fusion. And they called this literally fusion conservatism. And National Review was kind of the first magazine to bring all these different disparate thoughts together into one publication. This is really important, guys. That really kind of jump-started the entire intellectual conservative tradition. So real quickly, I'm just going to run through a few of these other strands of conservatism. You guys might have heard of some of these. Anybody heard the neocons, paleocons, alt-right? We're going to talk about all these people, yeah. So who are these people? You know, we've got this three-legged stool. George Nash, who's probably one of the most preeminent, conservative historian, would say that there's actually two more groups that exist within the conservative movement today. The first is the neoconservatives. They came a little later on in the 1960s. They didn't start right after World War II. The two big leaders in this movement were Irving Kristol. Any of you know Bill Kristol? That's his father, Irving Kristol. And Neil Poteritz, who is a big journalist too, started Commentary Magazine. So neoconservatism came about in the late 1960s. These were former liberals mugged by reality, was the joke that Irving Kristol would say of neoconservative. These guys were liberals more on a domestic front, but thought that the Democrats were not doing enough to win the Cold War, that liberals were actually, in some strange way, their philosophy kind of aligned with socialism a little bit, because the end result of liberalism is socialism. So they were scared of that. They also were disgusted by what was going on in the anti-war movement and all the upheaval in the 1960s. So their emphasis, though, is they want to promote a more active foreign policy. No one usually walks around and says, "Hi, I'm Chris, I'm a neoconservative." No one calls themselves that, but a lot of them are based in academia and journalism, and you'll see their influence a lot. Donald Rumsfeld, Dick Cheney, tend to lean more in that direction too. The other group, the fifth group, that formed in the late 60s, early 1970s, were called the social conservatives, or initially they were called the religious right. These are not the same as the traditionalists. It's a branch of traditionalism, but it was a group that was more interested in getting involved in politics. So the traditionalists wanted to focus on family, schools, churches, communities, private associations. Social conservatives said, "Now wait a minute, I'm all for that, but damn, we got to get in there and we got to do something here. Our culture is dissolving." So after Roe v. Wade happened, abortion on demand was legalized. That's when they started to form. Some of the big leaders in that, Phyllis Schlafly, who recently passed away, kind of considered the conservative matriarch or first lady of the conservative movement, started Eagle Forum, which was kind of the first pro-family organization in the country. Paul Weyrich is another guy who pretty much, there would not have been a Ronald Reagan, I think, without Paul Weyrich. He started the Heritage Foundation and ALEC and a lot of other big conservative groups. He also brought together people like, if you've ever heard the name, Jerry Falwell or Pat Robertson, those people together and convince them that you need to work together in order to have your values espoused in government. So their focus were on the social issues and getting active in politics. So these are the big five, all right? If you're an intellectual, conservative, historian, these are the big five that you want to know. A lot of people think of, "I know, I got a little of myself in all of this." It's true. I believe that. I've got a little of something in everything. But some people emphasize a little bit more with the other, and that's fine. There are some divisions, obviously, that we're going to get into. Here are some other groups that, again, no one really goes around saying, I'm a neocon, or hey, I'm a paleocon. But how many of you have heard of the term paleoconservative? Okay, not to be confused with the paleo diet. But some actually, good joke. They arrived after the Cold War ended. So after we won the Cold War, that anti-communism glue that held the libertarians, traditionalists, and even the neocons and the social conservatives together dissolved, because they didn't have that bringing them together anymore. The paleocons felt that the neoconservatives and their proactive foreign policy had pretty much dominated government, and they were very nervous about that. So Pat Buchanan is the big leader of this, along with M. Stanton Evans and a few others. More Pat Buchanan, that was a little bit more nationalistic. Their public policy tend to be more protectionist. When we talk about Trump and the alt-right in a minute, this is kind of the genesis of where Trumpism started from. It was through paleoconservatism. It had more of a pre-1945 foreign policy outlook. In other words, isolationism. Do not get involved in foreign entanglements. And they were criticized naturally for being isolationists. So the opposite of neocons is paleocon. Everyone with me so far? Okay. Constitutionalists. How many have heard of constitutionalist conservatism? Okay. A lot of people ascribe to this. It's the belief in the adherence to the Constitution, with an emphasis on originalism and judicial restraint, what we just talked about. Now, they call themselves constitutional conservatives. Some of the people that ascribe to this are Antonin Scalia, Clarence Thomas, Ted Cruz, and Mike Lee ascribe to this. And a lot of people these days tend to be calling themselves constitutional conservatives because their emphasis, well, we need to get back to the Constitution. That was our founding document. How many people have heard of Ayn Rand? Ayn Rand, yes. I can never say it right. Ayn Rand is the author of The Fountainhead and Atlas Shrugged, very popular books. Paul Ryan at one point said that he initially got interested in conservatism through Ayn Rand. Now, a lot of schools of thought on Ayn Rand and whether or not she should be considered a conservative. Bill Buckley, the titular head of the conservative movement, tried to squeeze her out, saying that her philosophy was zealously individualistic and capitalistic, and that Randian man was made center of a godless world, and that that should be run by a technocratic elite. And there's a certain truth to that. But a lot of people, a lot of people tend to get interested in conservatism through Rand, so we give them her at least a little credence here, just because she has gotten a lot of people interested in the ideas of individual liberty and promoting capitalism. Anybody heard of the reform cons, reformicons, or reform conservatives? Okay, it's another little branch of conservatism that recently came about. They wrote this book called Room to Grow, and believed that the American right's biggest problem was the economy, or was domestic issues, not necessarily social or defense. That the Reagan-era slogans don't work anymore, that the language that we used in the 1980s don't make sense for people today. Sometimes conservatives and libertarians tend to talk in these esoteric terms about the free market and the invisible hand, while most people don't speak like that. They wanted to put together a pragmatic platform that would deal with the day-to-day issues of people. They believe the Republican Party really has no real or pragmatic platform. They're criticized a little bit for being domestic neocons. But they're very influential, especially in the media. Ramesh Panuru, Yuval Levin, Rehan Salam, Russ Douthat from New York Times is considered. They call themselves reformicons. Yes, and they essentially believe in using government for conservative reform. All right, last two here. The Tea Party. How many people have heard of these? Yeah. Still around, I think. The Tea Party basically came about after the beginning of the Great Recession of 2008, and after Obamacare was pushed through Congress. And a lot of people were really concerned and upset by this for obvious reasons. They saw that the government was expanding its power beyond recognition. We've never seen something like this before. You know, George W. Bush, when he was leaving office, he had spent more in his administration than everybody from George Washington to Bill Clinton. And Obama now, he's taken it to another level. He's actually spent not only what George W. Bush did, but all the way back to George Washington too, and spent more money than anybody has ever spent before too. So they were primarily concerned with, it was a populist revolt concerned about the size and scope of government and desired getting back to our constitutional limited government roots. And you guys all know, I mean, this 2010-2014, unparalleled influence. They ran against the Republican establishment. They had alternative candidates and did a bang-up job. And they elected people like Jim DeMint, Ted Cruz, Mike Lee, Rand Paul, Marco Rubio, a lot of these guys. It really took on the establishment. It's kind of, the Tea Party is going through a little existential crisis right now. The irony with the Tea Party is that they didn't want to be organized. They want it to be a natural uprising, but you need to have some organization to grow a movement. So they're kind of going through this existential crisis. What do we do now? Obviously, Trump is probably not the ideal for Tea Partiers, but they're trying to figure that out. All right, so the last group, and this is really hard to discuss because we're living in this right now. Usually you have a few years, the arc of history, to kind of look back and explain these things. What is Trumpism and the alt-right? Academically speaking, I would say that they are a populist, almost libertine revolt against the established vestiges of power in the country. If you listen to Trump and you listen to people like Milo Yiannopoulos, they want to bring down the establishment. They believe that the establishment is corrupt and that everything that we've done up to this point has not been enough and we have to do more. We have to be provocative. We have to say things and do things, troll people, and all the stuff you hear about Milo and Trump, and in order to make a point. Even though it could be crude, it's to make a point. I believe that their heritage could be traced to the paleoconservatives. Listen to Trump. He sounds incredibly nationalistic and very protectionist. Conservatives are not known for their closing the free market. It's just the opposite. We're for free markets. But Trump seems to think that, it seems to believe that we need to have more protectionist policies. And they want to retreat from foreign entanglements, which is something similar to other branches of conservatism. They felt the Iraq War was the wrong war to fight, and they just want to just get out of all these foreign entanglements. Now, there are some, and I'm sure you've heard some other people talk about the alt-right. I mean, there's definitely some subpopulations that have a very, I think, dangerous tone brings out some of the worst in our politics. And you guys kind of know what I'm talking about, I assume. But there's two wings of it. There's the radical, what some people would say almost racism, to the more pragmatic, moderate version of the alt-right and Trumpism. And again, it's really hard to see how this is going to play out and how this is going to affect the conservative movement. Lastly, the future of the conservative movement, I'll end with this. What's going to happen? Anybody know? Trump going to win? Hillary going to win? Does it matter? There are a lot of... Thank you. A lot of people are... Conservatives are just starting to wrap their head around what does it mean to live in a post-Obama world. We haven't thought of it. We're so right in the now. We haven't even thought... Obama has brought all conservatives together. Dick Cheney at one point said that Barack Obama will be the best thing for the conservative movement because he'll bring everybody together. And he was kind of right. Many conservatives, regardless of their different emphases and rivalries and whatnot, came together to oppose Obama. But, you know, they might not have that in Hillary Clinton. Trump might be elected, and the coalitions are going to be changing and evolving. You also have a Republican establishment that nobody likes. Even if Trump were to lose, do people really want to go back to the previous Republican Party that we've had, that the John Boehner, the Mitch McConnell, all the Eric Cantor types that were squishy and rhinos? They weren't espousing and enacting on the conservatism that they campaigned on. You know what, and I got to be honest with you, there's a Republican establishment and there's also a conservative establishment. Conservatives are a victim of their own success. After Reagan, conservatism became incredibly popular for obvious reasons. They started creating think tanks and media organizations. There are associations and groups for every kind of policy issue that you can think under the sun. But the problem is, it's so diversified. There's not National Review, one publication to kind of bring everybody together. There's not one think tank like Heritage to bring all the scholars under one roof. So a lot of the conservative establishment, they've gotten somewhat complacent, well-intentioned, but a little lazy. Winning is not necessarily the priority for them, the long game is. And there's a certain truth, and I believe in that too. We can't just look at each election as it comes. You have to look at the long game here. But what happens is if you don't win every once in a while, and even if you do win after 2010 and 2014, did that seem to matter? Did the Republicans say what they were going to do after they won back Congress? So I think there's gonna need to be what I call an enema and a reformation of the conservative movement. And we need to consider, do we need a refusion of ideas or a new fusion of ideas? Because problems are different today. I'll leave with this, my last thing. I think we need a conservative reformation. I think the answer is not that complicated. I just think we got to get back to basics. What are the mobilizing ideas and principles that we all agree with? Faith, family, freedom. We believe in peace through strength, national defense. We believe in promoting families, churches, schools, and communities. We believe that the government, it was supposed to secure our rights, not grant and take away our rights, not tell us what bathroom to go into, not tell us not take away all our hard-earned earnings. I think we need to get back to the Constitution. That's the one document that brings all of us together. So I would challenge you after this weekend, read the Declaration of Independence, read the Constitution, and even read the Federalist Papers. And as we have these conversations during the post-election period, let's try to get back to basics and try to heal those wounds from all these different rivalries in a presidential campaign and try to move forward. Individual freedom, limited government, free market economy, strong national defense, and preserving the civil society. So I had a DVD. If you guys love this, and there's more, There's a six-hour series that Fox News did called The Right All Along with Brit Hume. Fantastic. I think it's like $9.99 to order on Amazon. If you really want to get more details about this, I base a lot of my class on this, and I show this throughout the semester, The Right All Along. Just look that up on Amazon. Guys, I was serious when I said I think of you as the real revolutionaries, because you're fighting this battle in the belly of the beast. And I hope, you know, this weekend will give you a lot of ideas and things to think about, and I hope I've been value added in doing that. So thank you very much. Can we take a speaker? One or two questions? Anybody have? If not, we can go to the bathroom and get drinks, but any questions? Bueller? Oh, okay. All right.
Hi, my name is Jake. I'm from Whitworth University in Spokane. And I realize that RINO, Republicans in name only, is a fantastic soundbite. It's fun to say, but with the reality of a Democratic president in the White House, and the fact of thinking of the two shutdowns that happened with the Republican Congress, how both times we were largely blamed for it when we took significant stands on Obamacare, which would have been a significant stand on a conservative principle. I'm just wondering, how might a practical approach, or how would you have envisioned them fulfilling their campaign promises, fighting for conservatism in a practical manner?
I think it's a great question. And you know what the easy answer is to that? Do what they say they were going to do during their campaign. And how do they go about doing that in a pragmatic way, in light of the reality? Exert your constitutional powers in Congress. You have the power of the purse in Congress. If the House of Representatives didn't want to fund Planned Parenthood, they could have stopped the funding for it. That was in their constitutional power to do so. You have runaway courts that are making decisions. They're making law. They're supposed to interpret, not make it. You could pass certain legislation that would force the president to at least deal with it and sign it. We can have those debates. But their power has been usurped by a very zealous executive in President Obama, and he's been, you know, I think history will look to him as he was somewhat successful. He got a lot of his stuff passed because we had a Congress that wasn't willing to stand on principle, do what they said they were going to do in their campaigns, and did not exert their constitutional power. They didn't have to create or become some tyrannical Congress. They could have just done what they were supposed to do. And I think they're going to be, you know, post-election, they're going to have to come to grips to that and figure out how to win back the legislative power. Well, thank you. All right. Guys, I'll be hanging around a little after, but thank you very much again.
All right, guys, we're just going to take a short break, but try to be back in your seats. Just use the restroom if you need to, but we want to try to stay as close to schedule as possible.
Thank you. That was awesome. Good job.
It's not too boring.
No. Not at all. This is...
Definitely know what, let me know what they think.
Yeah, I will.
Again, this is a presentation. I can lend this in so many different ways and go about it. Thank you so much for...